this is an incredibly fulfilled life. I took not one, but two different careers. And as a physician scientist, there were far too often instances where I'm trying to do an endoscopy and my clinical colleague would be telling me, "Pradipta, try to be a real clinician." So I'm not a real clinician somehow. And then I would enter the lab and my peers would tell me, "Be a real researcher," you know, like the PhDs in the lab. So I realized that I have chosen this path where I'm going to hear from both sides of this spectrum. I'm in the middle and I can talk the best of both worlds. I do fundamental basic research, just like a lot of my PhD colleagues. But when I see my patients see in me an MD doctor who has their best interest in their mind. This is an incredibly fulfilled life. I do want to make sure I bring up the other part, which is failures. If you have to pursue a career like mine and in two different disciplines, you get ready to face double the amount of disappointments, rejections, failures. You know, some of this can come in the form of having just a bad day in clinic, seeing something bad happen to your patients. I quickly realized I needed support. Support in a way that is on demand any day, any time. Guess what? I'm talking about your partner, spouse, and your child. So I'm fortunate to be one of them who has a supportive partner without whom I think any of this would be almost impossible. The reason I say that is because unless my spouse was very proud in what I did or I accomplished, or if I celebrated my success or felt low if I was coming home after a brutal day. Without having that kind of support, it's very hard to get through this career. You know, after I was fortunate enough to have my son, he took up quite a bit of that role. Most days he thinks his 1 hour cuddle time is actually for him. Not true. It's actually for me. It's probably one of those days where I need that cuddle time much more than he needs it. So that has been extremely, extremely, extremely therapeutic to get through this kind of a career. And I must say that it's a decision of who one chooses as a partner is a very important decision in career. Although it is called a life decision, it's actually a career decision. We just don't know about it. There is nothing conventional about this. It's a dream journey. Oh, maybe the only conventional part here is, yeah, I'm a woman. I did not think that was a handicap. I did not think for even a moment that was an important factor, and others didn't notice. Or even if they did, I didn't notice that they noticed. Maybe because I was too busy trying to just make sure that everything else that was on my path as a dream, my vision, every one of them, I was enabled, I was able, and I was supported at the right time by right people. As a student, I was curious, I was driven. I was the only student who went through entire medical school without buying a single book. And so the reason I could get away with that, and they were expensive textbooks, and one had to spend a lot of money to get the Harrison's textbook of medicine, Oxford textbook of medicine. So what I did, I would take my breaks from classroom. I would walk into the library. It's right next to the lecture hall. And I would sit there, leaf through a page, pages of a textbook. I would just go over the images. At the end of the session, I would flip the book back into the rack where it belonged and walk out of there. I would know exactly what's in that textbook. So I'm an extremely visual learner. And because of that reason, I pour every effort that I can in making best images, whether it is in my manuscripts, whether it is an article I'm writing, or whether it's a textbook chapter, or whether it is teaching students in classroom. Because I know that there is a good reason why people say a picture is worth 1,000 words. So I owe every bit of who I am today and what I am today to two people. Not my biological mother and father. Of course, I'm thankful that I'm born, but more importantly, my academic mother and father. So my very first training in science, literally walking in diaper stage, was with Stuart Kornfeld. He gave me a break that at that time in my career, I'm talking about 2001, newly minted medical student, graduated from India, never seen a lab before. Stuart Kornfeld gave me that opportunity to walk right in and train with him. He's the best biochemist you can find in this entire world, who is also a grade A mentor. And my most memorable times are still those days in WashU, St. Louis, Missouri, where it's a carefree time. He taught me how to fall in love with science. My second mentor and my academic mother is Marilyn Farquhar, and she's arguably the mother of cell biology. She taught me how to thrive in science. So one taught me how to fall in love with science, the other taught me how to survive, thrive in science. And so without those two mentors, a class of mentors that is really almost extinct, I must say, because that kind of attention to a career that is literally being born out of their hands in their labs, and being able to nurture my interests, keeping me as a focal point of what my dreams and ambitions are. It was truly incredible. Being there that time of my life and career was probably the most important reason why am I here today. From them, I learned many tangible and intangible things. Discipline. I would know, and I observed the importance of discipline. Stuart would walk in 7:00, not 6:59, not 7:01. It would be 7:00, dot on there. I was there 18 months. Not a single day was offbeat. What they did, both of them, Stuart and Marilyn, what they did, how they did, why they did, I observed them up close. And that kind of access is key to being a great mentor. And both of them had very minimal travel, and I still today maintain least travel that I can, because availability and access of a mentor are most important determinants of whether the mentee could have enough contact, enough training, enough mentorship, what it is. To this date, I reach out to Stuart if I'm in a bind, I have a question. And so these are relationships that are really whole life, worth preserving whole life. With Marilyn, we had a very special relationship. Every Wednesday noon, we would walk out for lunch together, and I would be able to bounce off any questions, even as a faculty, as a full professor. It didn't matter, because mentorship never ended the moment I became independent. And that's very important. So these are really the most important two people in my life who shaped who I am today. And there was another thing that's very important here, speaking of mentors. Think about it. With that kind of pedigree, when your resume says that you have trained with Stuart, Kornfeld, and Marilyn Farquhar, you're in trouble. And I'll tell you why. Because you cannot make up an excuse for why you did not succeed when you have that kind of mentorship. It's very hard for anybody to buy that. So there was a low level of anxiety all the time during my career transition, where I knew that failure was not an option here. I should do well because I have been mentored right, and I have everything that I needed to succeed. In the clinic, there are so many diseases that I see today. I have read about them and in my medical school textbooks. We still don't have a cure. Forget cure. If we have tablets that we hand out, most of the time it's a toss of a coin if that particular patient is going to benefit. What we are doing here is to achieve both precision and personalization in medicine. This is what I struggle every day to do in my clinic. My mother was unfortunately diagnosed with ovarian cancer, and she fought a battle 3.5 years. And as a physician, even though I told her she'll be okay, we'll fight it together, I knew it was a losing fight. But we went through it together and met the same endpoint that we had all worried would be upon us. And when she passed away in 2017, January, I thought to myself, this is exactly what I study. I study in my lab how tumor cells escape, how they learn, they adapt, and then they turn into something worse despite all the treatment we throw at them. It inspired me to go into something that has never been tried before, which is decode the signaling inside cells, the rules it follows. Because if we know what those rules are, we could be better equipped to hijack them, corrupt them, manipulate them, so on and so forth. And although we had, over the decades come to know how cell communicate, how it communicates inside was really never understood well enough. Forget about knowing what the rules are. So here is what inspired me to get into network medicine. The web of communication network inside a cell, or the network of biology that connects every cell to another cell, molecules to other molecules, genes to other genes, RNA to another RNA. Everything is interconnected. Here is where I got the inspiration to go at network medicine. We established together with three of my colleagues the Institute for Network Medicine. One of its centers tackles the big data, because the information era has poured over gigabytes and gigabytes and terabytes of data. We now need to take that data, extract information. From information, there should be insight. And that insight should help us come up with better targets to go at, so that the cell doesn't escape the chemotherapy, so that we can actually choke it on its track to becoming something uglier. There is the center where we actually rebuild in three dimensions, human tissues, tumors, or disease models, and that is the humanoid core. And that is where we can test the drug in human tissue, so that we are not jumping from mice to actual patients, but we take them through a more logical approach, a better model system. And the third center is concise, where we are very much interested in decoding that fundamental signaling rules so that we can then manipulate those and interfere with those to better understand how to trip over ourselves. So some of the questions we are trying to answer, they're not one man, one woman job, period. Not even one discipline. So some of these studies require math, computer science, microbiology, virology, tissue engineering, stem cell biology. No one person can do all of that. So what is uniquely possible and can be done right here at UC San Diego is I could go around and handpick a team of talented faculty who came right in there and said, I'd like to be a part of this movement to do drug discovery differently. And hence we have talent from every potential department you can think of, young, mid-career faculty, senior faculty, all walks of discipline who have joined together to help in this initiative. Without such kind of cross-pollination of ideas, disciplines, things like these are extremely difficult to accomplish. And hence, I'm absolutely grateful that when I reached out to all of these colleagues of mine, colleagues became friends, friends became colleagues, we grew as a team, and we could do something that none of us individually could. I've been increasingly thinking about this question, what legacy am I going to leave? I think of it as two things, people and the product I leave behind. The lives that I get to touch, shape, form, their careers, the moment they leave my lab, they're ambassadors of my lab. That is how I see as a piece of me still there after long after I'm gone. The second part is the product. In this Institute for Network Medicine, one of those would be the drugs, the biomarkers, the models for research that we leave behind for the other scientists to use. All of these combined together, if they stand the test of time, I would think I've done a good job. If they touch other people's lives, I would think I have left a strong legacy.